Tonight we are going to start the third lockdown in Israel, and maybe the worst ever. From what I see around me, the people that are so many people that are sick, including my own son, who just got the result today in his gun in the kindergarten. He got a positive result for coronavirus. No, I'm not worried. Little children don't even feel it. He's been having it for a few days, probably, because he's been at home for a while, and we don't see any change in his behavior. Still as naughty as usual. And so nothing's changed. And so very cute. But it's something that is happening all over. And I want to start by wishing a speedy recovery for those who are sick, and not only in Israel, in the whole world. Please God, this disease that we already think that we see the end of it, now it's becoming stronger on us. Hopefully it will be the last seger, the last lockdown, and it will be the end. As we're going to read in the parsha in a few weeks, it says in the pasuk, כל המחלה אשר שמתי ומצרים לא אשים עליך, כי אני השם רופאיך. That all those diseases I will take away from you, says God, as I'm your doctor, I'm your physician, and so don't worry. Today we want to talk about the Rambam, that it was his yortzeit this week. It's been 816 years since he died, exactly on the 20th of Tevet, which was this week. And for a long time, I've been wanting to summarize and investigate what is the Rambam say about the proper way of life. Let's first give a few words about who he was, so you understand how important he actually was. Rabbi Moshe ben Maimon, as they call him in English, Maimonides, he was born at the year 1138, right? Almost 900 years ago in Spain. And he learned many things, and that's why he was so special, that he learned Torah from his father originally, then from other rabbis, and he learned other, what we can call wisdoms, or philosophy and science and many other things. And then he became a big medical doctor later on in life. And like many Jews, at the age of 11, 12, 13, not exactly sure, the whole family of Rambam had to flee from Spain because of the Muslims there. And they ran originally to Morocco. I was lucky to be at his house in the city of Fez in Morocco. And it was quite interesting. And then they probably, he went to Israel, but it didn't last very long, not in Morocco, not in Israel. And like they say, the wandering Jew, they moved from place to place. Eventually the Rambam got to Cairo in Egypt. That's where he was. And he was mainly learning Torah, a little bit of teaching, but mainly learning. You know, from a teacher, you don't make a living. So the one that to sponsor him was his father originally, and then his brother. They saw his greatness and they were nice to him, until tragedy after tragedy happened in his life. His father died. His brother, David, drowned with his sheep. He was a big businessman. And so Rambam had to look after himself. And the way to do it, he went as by the way, or not by the way, to learn medicine. And very quickly, because he was such a brilliant mind, he became the biggest doctor in the whole area. And he became the personal doctor of the Sultan, Salah ad-Din. He asked him to be his personal doctor. And he was at the same time also the leader of all the Jewish people in the whole of Egypt, not only in Cairo, but in the whole of Egypt. He was the spiritual leader and the dayan, right, the judge, and in the whole area. And not only that, he was well known in the whole Jewish world. And you have to understand, to be well known in the whole Jewish world today, we have internet, it's easy. But at the time, it was something unheard of. But yet he was, and he used to receive questions from all over the world. Specifically, the people who liked him the most were the Yemenite Jews. And although he's never been to Yemen, the Yemenite Jews liked his rulings and followed him. To this day, many Yemenites follow his rulings. Most of the other Jews, what we call Ashkenazi and Sephardi, they go by more recent rabbis. But the Rambam is very much influential on the whole halakha that we actually rule. And he wrote many books, not only halakha books. At the age of 30, he already published his amazing book called Mishneh Torah. Perusha Mishnayot. It was a commentary on the whole six books of the Mishnah, and that's where he showed how amazing his knowledge was of Torah. But his most famous book is what I mentioned now by mistake, Mishneh Torah. Mishneh Torah was originally called Hayad HaChazaka, the mighty hand, as we can translate it, but it's actually a play on words, because Yad Chazaka is a mighty hand, but it's also Yad is Yud plus Dalet. Yud is 10, Dalet is 4. There are 14 sections to that book, and at his generation, some rabbis were originally upset, and they said to the Rambam, how can your book be called Mishneh Torah, secondary to the Torah? Are you second to Moses? There was Moses at Mount Sinai, and then 1,500 years of rabbis, you don't care about them, and you next, who do you think you are? But then when they read his book, they realized that actually it is a very revolutionary, a very much of an important book to the whole Jewish people, and it is, since then and to this day, very much learned. If Moses received on Mount Sinai the five books of Moses, the whole Torah that we have, Rabbi Moshe, again Moses, Ben Maimon, summarized the whole oral Torah. And from the minute you wake up in the morning until you go to sleep, from the minute you're born until we die, we have everything specified there, exactly what we need to do. Very clear, is very accurate. It's no wonder that they said about the Rambam, Mi Moshe ad Moshe lo kam ke Moshe. Mi Moshe Rabbeinu, from Moses at Mount Sinai to Rabbi Moshe ben Maimon, there wasn't someone as great as they are. Not only those books he wrote about the Jewish law, but also about Jewish philosophy. And his famous book called Moreh Nevuchim, or in English, Guide for the Perplexed, is not such easy book, but it's a book that really was translated to many languages, written in Arabic originally, and it's a book that really influenced the Jewish philosophy and Jewish thoughts to this day. People still follow Rambam way of thinking, and he didn't make it up. Obviously, he's carrying on a tradition, and that's how it was. As we said, in his personal life, he had tragedies. Maybe he had two sons who died. Only one son survived, the son called Avraham. And that's his only son that we know of. And his wife also died. He got married late. And as we said, that he was working very hard as a physician for the important people there. And yet he had time to write his books and also to lead the Jewish people. Only someone like Rambam can do such a thing. Aside from all this, he also wrote books in medicine. And his books were learned until about 100 years ago. They were very much well known all over the world. Medicine advanced a lot in the past few dozen years, but for hundreds of years, He was really very important in the whole medicine world, and he well known not only in the Jewish world but also outside the Jewish world for his books in medicine. The Rambam is a great rabbi and physician. Being a combination as such, he managed to write books about halakha that will bring in the medicine into it. He wasn't scared to say that the Talmud that was written 300-400 years before him is actually 500-600 before him. Is actually something that is not relevant anymore in many ways. And he wasn't scared to say, no, our medicine advanced and changed, and therefore I'm not going to give you the law as it says in the Talmud, but it's going to be different. That's what he wrote. And obviously it doesn't change the laws of the Torah, but in terms of medication, he says this is something that does change. And he was very much into a healthy mind in a healthy body. Those two things must go together. They must come combined, that if you want to be healthy, then you have to have a healthy mind with a healthy body. And he said those revolutionary things, and it's no wonder that he got the nickname of Hanesher HaGadol. Hanesher HaGadol, the great eagle or vulture, whether it's called this huge bird that is called the king of the birds. And it can look from very far away, can see with the good eyes. That's the Rambam exactly, with his good eyes and with his ability to express himself. He wrote such clear books, which is quite amazing. So what did the Rambam say about the corona? You're right, nothing. He didn't know about the corona. But he did say many things about how to keep a healthy body in a healthy mind. And he's first talking about the mind. And he said the mind is the most important thing. The soul, the neshama, the nefesh, that's the most important thing. And the Rambam starts by saying, if you have a disease, if a plague comes, right, like we have now, the first thing you have to do is pray. Mitzvat aseh min haTorah, he writes in his Halachot of Ta'aniyot, lizok, shout out to God, please help me. We have to pray harder. That's the first thing we have to do when something bad happens to you. And that applies to any trouble, not just a plague, not just a pandemic, but many things. And you have to shout and pray and beg for help from God, because He can help. As we said at the beginning of the Pasuk, Ani Hashem Rofecha, I am God, your healer. I can heal you. And so we have to pray to God. And he says, "Lo asak velo ta'anit gormim ela tshuva u'ma'asim tovim." Rambam brings the story of Jonah. I don't know if you remember the book, the small book in the Tanakh called Yonah. And there, Yonah is being sent to talk to the people of Nineveh, tell them to do tshuva and to repent and to fix their ways. And lo and behold, surprisingly, they listened to Yonah. Yonah doesn't want it, leave it alone, but they start tearing their clothes, and they put ashes on themselves, and they start crying out for God, and saying, please help us. But when God does forgive them for their wrongdoing, it doesn't say that God saw that they actually did tshuva, that they repent. Sorry, it doesn't say that the God saw the sack that they were wearing and tearing the clothes. No. God saw their good actions, that their heart was in the right place. And that's what the Rambam emphasized. It's not about the external things that you do. Don't give us a show. It's what's inside. And if you want to be able to deal with the disease, you have to fix your ways. Utshuva, utfila, utzdaka, as we shout it at Yom Kippur and Rosh Hashanah, Rambam says, that's the way for getting rid of all wrong things happening around us. Tshuva, repentance, tefillah, prayers, and tzedakah, charity, given to the people that have less. It comes to remind us that who is the king of the universe, as we say in the bracha after the bathroom, Rofe kol basar umafli la'asot, makes wonders, that is God. And only thanks to him, things can happen. Yet, the Rambam emphasizes, not only the soul, it must come in fixing your body as well. And how do you fix your body? First, preventative medicine. Try not to get into trouble. And the Rambam says a sentence that if he wouldn't have said it, I don't know who would dare to say. Kol hamanhig atzmo bedrachim elu. Whoever leads his life in those ways that I will teach you, eino ba lidei holi kol yamav. No sickness will come to you ad sheyazkin harbe veyamut, until you get old and die naturally, healthy. That's what he says. He said, if you follow my lead, if you say what I'm telling you to do, then you won't be sick. Then the Rambam says, but you know, unless it's some kind of a pandemic, then nothing I can do. Really it's not in your hands, and because someone ate the what do you call this flying mouse, the bat, someone ate the bat. Now it's spread. I don't know if it's true or not, but that's what they say. Originally they said it. I don't know. I didn't hear it for a while. Maybe they don't think of it anymore. Yes, if you want to be healthier, follow my leads. And I'm going to give you a few examples of what the Rambam says, how to follow his leads. The Rambam says, and I'm quoting from a beautiful article written by Professor Avshalom Mizrahi. He says, how to lead healthy life, and he gives there all the recommendations and all the instructions and all the suggestions that the Rambam gives to keep healthy life. And he says, beware of the fact that most people are born healthy. And that shows you that that's how you should stay. If you don't make mistakes, then you're going to stay healthy. And that's how it should stay. God wants you to stay that way, Rambam says to us, because obviously if you're sick, you cannot do anything good. And God wants you to do good. So he wants you not to be sick. So if you stick, and Rambam emphasizes a lot, chukei hateva, the laws of nature. If you keep to the laws of nature, and I told you that in Hebrew, hateva, if you look at the word, hey, tet, bet, ayin, those letters, comes to the numerical value of 86, which is the same numerical value of Elohim, also 86. God is 86. The laws of nature, 86. It's hinting that the laws of nature are the laws of God. And if you want to be healthy, follow this lead. And he gives a whole list. And he says, the Rambam, when you come to eat, don't eat too much. Don't get full. If you fill up your stomach, you're making yourself sick. And I'm not saying to you, I'm saying to myself, because I'm terrible with that. Because who doesn't get to a place where there's good food? There's always place for dessert, right? You know the sentence? There's always place for dessert. Well, the Rambam says, you're going to pay for it. You're going to pay for it. Rather not. He says, think in advance about the dessert. And when you eat, don't eat more than 3/4 of how much your stomach can take. And that's what he says. You must leave a quarter empty. That's how do you count that? It's difficult. So you know how much do I need? How much do I eat? And I'm full, and you should eat only 3/4 of that. Again, I'm talking to you, to me, not to you, because I'm very bad at it, and I wish I would be better. And the Rambam says, listen to this. The Rambam says to us, you can eat the wrong foods. You can eat whatever the fat and whatever things that the worst thing, as they say, that can medicine doesn't like. But if you eat a little bit of it, you'll be fine, because the body knows how to deal with it. But when you eat too much of something, then it's too much for the body. And that's what the Rambam emphasized all the time. I'm not giving you the quotes, but it's there. If you want to read the Hebrew, it's all in front of you. He says, a wise person doesn't eat too much. Be wary of that. Be careful. And more than that, you should eat only when you're hungry. You should drink only when you're thirsty. You shouldn't hold in when you need the toilet. When you need the bathroom, you should go to the bathroom straight away. Don't hold it in. Don't wait. It's very unhealthy. That's what it says. It says that when you want to eat, I don't know if it's true according to today's medicine, but in terms of when you come to eat, don't eat straight after you sleep. You have to let the body wake up first. That's what it says. Work a little bit or walk a little bit. Get the body awaken and then relax, and only then you sit and eat. And you sit and eat. You shouldn't eat while walking. That's what it says. And where does the Rambam give us all those instructions? It's amazing. The Rambam teaches us all those things, not in his books of medicine, in his halakha books. What we call Hilchot Deot, he's got a whole section about opinions. I don't know if they translate like that or not. But in Hilchot Deot, we have two huge chapters talking about how you keep healthy. Because a healthy mind in a healthy body. And if you want to be a better person, if you want to worship God or whatever, do things correctly, then you have to keep a healthy body. And then he gives a whole list of kinds of foods that you should eat or shouldn't eat and what they do to you. I'm skipping all the fruits and vegetables. What's important for me, I was shocked to read, Rambam says to us, which is the healthiest meat? What do you think? You'll be surprised to hear. The healthiest meat one can eat is pork. The best meat that one can eat, the Rambam, the big doctor says, the pig is the best meat to eat. After that, lamb, after that, calf, baby cow, and that's the order. That's what he says. The Rambam in another place, I didn't quote it here, but in his other book, Moreh Nevuchim, Guide for the Perplexed, he says that the reason we don't eat pork is A, and most importantly, because God said so. Finished. I don't understand why. But I do understand to an extent, says the Rambam, because if you look at markets where they have porks, where they sell this pig, then it's very dirty. I don't know if you've ever seen a pig being slaughtered. They shout. They shout and scream, and they're very messy. That's what he says. And I've seen it, actually, and it's true. And he says in markets where you don't have pigs, the whole market is cleaner. That's what he says. And then he says maybe God wants us to clean, to keep a clean place, and that's why we don't eat pig. Not because it's not healthy. It is the best meat to eat, but you shouldn't. And the Rambam says to us, most important, when you come to eat meat, do it in order, from light to heavy. So if you have a whole meal, you start with the eggs, then the chicken, then the goats, and only then the cow. That's the order of things, from light to heavy, because the heavy meat is more difficult to digest. And he says, try not to mix it with others, and it's only the stomach when it's working, then it's okay to eat it. The Rambam gives a whole huge emphasis on the concept of working out, the concept of going to the gym and keeping healthy in terms of cardiovascular, like you get your heart rate going and you do lots of exercise. That's very important. As I said, Rambam says, if you keep exercising and you don't fill yourself with food, then it's not a problem even if you eat unhealthy things. You're okay with it as long as you do those things. And he says most of the diseases that we have got to do with the lack of exercise and the overeating. Finished. That's what he says already 850 years ago. That's the Rambam said it. I don't know if anyone said it before him. I don't know of anyone saying before him. But he was first to say, and when it wasn't so popular at his time, I think at his time, like the time of the Tanakh, do you know how they call someone who is very fat? Do you know what the word for that in the time of the Bible? For fat, they say bari. Bari is healthy. So they actually call someone fat healthy, because to an extent it was true, because maybe a famine comes and there's nothing to eat. So what are you going to eat? So I've got reserves. You know, I've got, how do you call those tires around my stomach to keep me warm and happy. And so I would live longer than you, because I have extra weight that if there won't be food, I'll have reserves to use. Nowadays, medicine say it's wrong. The Rambam didn't say it, right? In the time of the Talmud, they said it. The Rambam says, no, don't get fat. Don't overeat. It's not good for you. The Rambam gave us the abbreviation for the word bri'ut. Bri'ut. How do you keep healthy? Bet, Reish, Yud, Aleph, Vav, Taf. Teaching us three things. If you want to keep healthy, three things. A, bri'ut, bolem, rugzo. Stop your anger. Don't get upset. Bolem rugzo. Again, we're talking about the mind. Talking about a healthy mind. B, yafchit ochlo. You should minimize or lower the amount of how much you eat. Don't eat too much. And C, bri'ut, vav taf at the end, ve'yarbe tnu'ato. And you should exercise. And you should walk. And you should don't overdo that either, but you should exercise and get your heart rate going. That's what it says. In addition, the Rambam teaches us that you have to take a shower, and you have to, you know, think that may be obvious for us today, but he says start with warm water, and then you go to cold water, and you have to wash and give yourself a little massage on your body. That's what he says. He said you have to get your blood going, and it's good for your health. Aside from those healthy things, he said, for the mind, how do you keep a mind healthy? He says, don't go to any extreme. If someone walks what he calls the golden path, then he would be healthy. As we said, don't get upset, unless it is something very important to be upset about, but then only for a while, for a short while, be upset and get over it. Don't crave things too much. The key here is too much. Don't give the body things that are too much. Don't give the soul things that are too much. Don't be a miser, and don't spread your money all over the world. Don't be too happy. Don't be too sad. That's what he says. You should look after your way of behaving and try to control it. Try to educate yourself that you do it in the right way. That's the Rambam in his halakha book teaching us how to walk the golden path, because it's going to keep you healthy. Because a healthy mind in a healthy body. He explained the pasuk in the book of Dvarim. It says, ונשמרתם מאוד לנפשותיכם. You should look after your souls. Most people explain that sentence by saying, look after your body. Rambam says, no, the soul is the main thing. That controls the body. So look after the soul. And you should remember that the body controlled by the soul, and you should keep them both healthy. That's what he says, that you have to find a way to heal your soul, and that's going to heal your body as well. The Rambam says that the big difference between medicine and religion is that the medicine looking after your body and the religion is looking after your soul, and therefore you need to combine them together. And how do you do it? You listen to both. What does the body tell you? What is a natural way of keeping your body healthy? And also what the Torah tells you to keep your soul healthy by keeping the right set of values and morals, and you go with the principles of the religion, and that's going to keep you in line and doing the right thing. And only this combination of body and soul that is going to work together. And he says, how do you keep your soul healthy if someone is soul is not healthy? He says, give them something nice to smell. The smell is good for the soul. That's what he says. He said music is good for the soul. If you play music next to someone who is sick, it's going to help them, right? Obviously, the music that they like, it's going to help them get better sooner. The right music helps. You tell them happy stories. You tell them something to make them happy, because if the soul is happy, then the body will be happy. And that's how it works. And that's what the Rambam says. And if you keep all those things, then you will be healthy forever. So says the Rambam. And so the body is just a tool, the whole soul, and the soul keeps the body going and should do it in the right way. Aside from doing sports, right, exercise and taking medication when you have to, that's when you're really stuck already, but eating the right way, we have to keep a high level of morality, and with that you're going to get closer to God. And the Rambam brings the beautiful play on words again. I told you already a few, but play on words. The one of the highest names of God is Yud and Hey and Vav and Hey, right? You see it written in the Torah. We don't say that word, but it's written. It's a very holy word. Yud, as we say it, Yud Kei Vav Kei. That word we don't pronounce, but we do write it. The numerical value of it is 26. 26 is double the word Ahava. God's name is double Ahava. Ahava is love. Ahava is 13. So twice 13, that's going to get you to God. If you operate in your life with the love of people and with the love of God, and you come and you don't go to any extremes, that's going to keep you healthy. That's what he says. And with that optimistic note, I think we can also end here. Unless you have any questions, I'm just going to end off with a pasuk from Yirmiyahu. Ki a'ale arucha lach umimakotayich erpa'ech ne'um Hashem. I will give you medication. I will heal you, says God. Don't worry, I'm looking after you. Rambam says and helps us how to get to it by keeping a healthy body a healthy soul. Any questions? No? You want to ask?
Yes.
Please.
I wanted to ask, what makes big a healthy food, a healthy meat?
Say it again.
What makes pig the healthiest pork, the healthiest meat?
I don't know why he says it. Maybe there's less fat in certain areas of the pig.
Okay, I'm gonna look it up. And the other thing, ahava means love.
Ahava
and this number 13.
Yeah.
why it's not from Jewish people, but why is 13 considered a bad, like a bad number?
That's not in Judaism. In Judaism, 13 is a very good number.
So it didn't come from this?
No, it's not come from Judaism, no. Okay. 13 is a good number, Bas.
Yes, I know. I'm just saying, do they maybe have this against the Ahava?
You think maybe they don't want Ahava. They don't have Ahava. Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah. No, okay, fine. That's it.
Anyone else? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And thank you, Rabbi.
Good night, Laila Tov.
Bye.
Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Thank you.